The acute chronic workload ratio has gained a great deal of attention in sports science in recent times. In this video, then, we're going to dive into the underpinning research on the ratio, discussing various considerations for the calculation of it, as well as the criticisms and limitations of the ratio. So you can decide whether it's a must-use calculation in your training load monitoring system, or whether, in fact, it has been debunked. And before we just dive into this topic of the acute chronic workload ratio, I want to give you a quick reminder that if you do want to dive deeper into this topic of load monitoring and learn the data analysis and visualization skills to use in Microsoft Power BI, then definitely check out our Fundamentals of Load Monitoring course in collaboration with Sport Horizon, which we have designed specifically to provide you with the knowledge of the underpinning science and research on these topics, as well as the applied skills to visualize your load monitoring data in Microsoft Power BI. Whilst it may have seemed like a brand new, exciting concept, like many things in sports science, it was actually built upon historic research, and namely Eric Bannister's research into training theory in the 1970s. This work identified that in response to a training stimulus, an individual will have an immediate term negative effect on their physical performance, which are our fatigue effects, as well as a longer term positive effect on physical performance, which is fitness. And it was thought that this chronic workload represents this fitness effect, whereas the acute workload represents this fatigue effect. In recent times, then, this specifically acute chronic workload ratio kind of burst onto the scene around 2015, 2016. And it probably gained such attention because the word predict was used in some of those early studies. But actually, they were association studies, so it was in fact a correlation and not necessarily a causation effect. We'll get into all the limitations and criticisms of the ratio later on in this video, so make sure you're watching to learn more about that. But for now, let's just discuss what that calculation is and all our different considerations if we're going to use it. So the acute chronic workload ratio obviously is a simple ratio. We are dividing the acute load by the chronic load. It was thought that by comparing a immediate acute recent time frame to a longer term time frame, you get a sense of how well prepared that individual was for their recent workload compared to what they've done over time. A ratio of one represents that the acute load is the same as the chronic load. A ratio higher than that shows that the acute load has been relatively higher than the chronic load. Or a ratio less than one suggests the acute load is less than chronic load. And of course, those acute and chronic time frames are naturally different lengths. So we can't divide the total, otherwise the chronic will always be much higher than the acute. So we might use either a daily rolling average or a weekly rolling average. Here we have then an example of an acute chronic workload ratio for any metric here, perhaps some sort of sprint distance, whereby the acute daily average over that time frame is 335 divided by 549 for that whole chronic average time frame gives us our ratio of 0.6. But often people also use the average or the sum for the weekly training load. So then you do the acute here, for example, being 2026 for our most recent week, and then our average weekly training load of, say, the 4 weeks prior to that, averaged out at 3486, gives us also a ratio of 0.6 in this case. As we'll get into, there are, of course, massive limitations with using these various approaches. There is so much more to this calculation than just that. We're going to touch upon some of the decisions to be made around the calculation, as well, of course, as the criticisms in this video briefly. But of course, there's a lot more that we can dive into. And hopefully you'll have a look at some of the other videos on this channel, as well as perhaps that course, to learn even more. So with this acute chronic workload ratio, we have a number of decisions in terms of how to calculate it. We have to decide what time frames we're using. 8 and 28 days or 1 week and 4 weeks are most commonly used, but doesn't necessarily mean that that's best. We can obviously calculate this ratio for all the metrics that we're using, both internal load as well as external load, and every single metric. So what are we going to focus our attention on? with the calculation. We can also choose to do coupled versus uncoupled method, as well as then the rolling average compared to the exponentially weighted average. I'll briefly explain what both of those are, as well as then what thresholds are we using for our alerts. And that's when we get to the infamous sweet spot. And we're going to discuss that as well. So what timeframes and metrics do you use if using the acute chronic workload ratio? Well, this study in Australian rules football from David Carey and his colleagues tested 336 different combinations of various metrics and timeframes. They found that moderate speed running was the metric that was most sensitive, as well as then a time frame of either 3 to 6 days for the acute compared to 21 or 28 days, best explained injury risk in their setting and their data set. Ideally, we would use a statistical approach like this to try and understand what may be best in our environment, but without the ability to do that, it's up to you to use critical thought around what metrics might be most relevant in your sport, as well as what timeframes would be most relevant. If you're working in ice hockey, for instance, where you have games multiple times a week, you may use different acute and chronic timeframes compared to, say, American football that has one game a week, or even perhaps football, soccer, which often, although they have two games a week frequently, tends to still follow kind of a weekly periodization. We also then have our decisions around coupled versus uncoupled. So in the traditional coupled method, the acute timeframe is included as part of the chronic time frame. So the acute time frame may be the most recent week, and the chronic time frame would be perhaps the most recent 4 weeks, which includes that acute time frame within it. So you're essentially comparing part of a number to itself within the ratio, which can cause a false or spurious correlation. Instead, the uncoupled approach then takes that acute load out of the chronic time frame, either using a chronic time frame of the preceding 3 weeks, or still making it 4 weeks, and of course, dividing it to make that still a weekly load. And some researchers suggested this would be a more appropriate approach by not including the acute load in your chronic load. There was also debate in the literature about whether to use a rolling average for the calculation or an exponentially weighted moving average. So a rolling average treats every day within that time frame the same. So if you were just calculating the average over 7 or 28 days, you just divide them all by those number of days and have it all treated the same. However, it was felt that just using an average, therefore, overlooks the variation in that time frame in terms of the training load patterns. And that was really well illustrated here in this example of three different athletes, all with the same acute chronic workload ratio, but clearly a very different pattern to their training load. In addition, if we think back to that original work on training theory and the results of a training stimulus and their fitness and fatigue effects, the effect of a training stimulus declines over time. The effect of my training from 28 days ago clearly is not having the same impact on my body as my training from yesterday. And so when we use a rolling average, this neglects that key physiological, biological aspect. So a better way to calculate the acute chronic workload ratio was put forward by using this exponentially weighted moving average, whereby there is a degree of decay applied to the training load. So then this decay assigns a decreasing weighting for each older training load value. And for more on the specifics of how you can calculate this and set this up with your own training load data, we go into this in a lot more detail on our Fundamentals of Load Monitoring course. So if you've decided to use the acute chronic workload ratio, you've decided what timeframes to utilize in your sport and the best approach for the calculation, then you want to probably decide what threshold you're going to use. And you will have seen undoubtedly this so-called sweet spot figure that has been widely shared since its publication. However, this figure really has been criticized and somewhat debunked in terms of having this sweet spot versus the danger zone. The criticism specifically of this figure is that the data was grouped, and yet it's dealing with a continuous variable in the acute chronic workload ratio, and that's statistically problematic and created this illusion of the relationship. But that disappears then if you were to remove the outliers. Specifically, if you look at the data points at 2.0 for the ratio, these actually vary quite a lot. And if we only look at the data below that 2.0 ratio, then actually the study found that the connection between the acute chronic workload ratio and injury risk disappears altogether. Again, this is another great example of the danger of discretizing continuous data into these buckets or these groups. And that's certainly a limitation as well when we're dealing with things like high-speed running or accelerations and decelerations and how we bucket these continuous data into these groups. And let's dive deeper into the criticisms and limitations around the acute chronic workload ratio. Unfortunately, that early attention around being able to predict injury has not come to fruition. It is simply too complex in terms of injury risk. And this is clearly a very simplified ratio because it's unable to consistently predict injury risk that diminishes its practical value for practitioners, as well as these creation of these thresholds we were just talking about really does compromise the validity and highlight some of the statistical limitations. There's key papers here that really dive into the criticisms of the ratio, and they focus on this flawed theoretical foundation that it, as I said, completely oversimplifies the link between workload and injury. There's mathematical concerns that it uses an inappropriate normalization process. So by converting it into a ratio, it can distort the data and it often leads to misleading interpretations. And actually in this research, they've shown that perhaps it is not even more sensitive than just contrived figures for the chronic time frame. So they recommend moving on altogether from this ratio. So do I use the acute chronic workload ratio? Well, you have to dive into our course to find out a little bit more about my thoughts and dive deeper into some of this research that I've just covered in brief today. So that's the fundamentals of load monitoring in collaboration with Sports Horizon. And of course, I'll put a link below for you to check out all the details on that. Hope you found this video useful. If you did, please like and subscribe so you don't miss out on another Sports Science Insights video coming very soon.